heart. How long, O Lord, how long? How long, O Lord, till everyone can be free and whole and loved, till everyone is valued and the world is ready to welcome what they were born to contribute? How long till the old, old conflicts are resolved and we can move on? How long till the planet itself is healthy and we don't need to feel guilty anymore? How long till we can let go and just breathe in the good thing it is to be alive? There is a direct line from that cry, which is in Hebrew words, but surely universal to the human race. Direct line from that cry, O Lord, how long, to the ministry of Jesus. When he proclaimed the kingdom of God right around the corner, he was speaking to everybody everywhere whose heart might be crying, O Lord, how long? That is to say, he was speaking to all of us. He was speaking to those people in detention, speaking to the crying children. God is real. God is here. There is a dream of how the world would be if it were truly aligned with God's will, which right now it is not. And the dream is powerful. Its power is a here and now sort of power, because sometimes you see the dream right in front of your eyes, real for you, and it knocks you over. Joy, rightness, blessing, hope, relief, possibility. In our reading, Jesus comes blazing onto the scene right at the beginning of his ministry. The time has come. The kingdom is at hand. Turn around, believe. And then, because words are only the beginning, he shows the people what he means. First, he has a showdown with a demon, the very first action in the ministry of Jesus, according to Mark. He's preaching, and a man challenges him, only it isn't the man. It's a demon speaking through him. What are you doing here, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? We know who you are. Jesus orders the demon out, and the man is free. It's no accident that this is the first miracle of the story. Now, you and I are far too scientific and sophisticated to believe in demons. But let them stand for all the corruption, the greed and misery, and xenophobia and violence and prejudice and hatred and cynicism, all those things that wreck people's lives. And we'll be saying, go, Jesus, go. Then comes one of the most amazing scenes in the Bible, an enormous scene of healing. Everyone from miles around brings their sick people, their families, their friends, and Jesus heals them all. There's a second huge sign of what the kingdom of God is about when it's alive in our midst. And then Jesus and his followers head up down the road. A leper comes to him. If you choose, he says to Jesus, you can make me clean. Mark tells us that Jesus is moved with pity and reaches out to touch the man. I do choose, he says, be clean. And you've all heard the sermon. You know that that means that somebody isolated and excluded and lonely can now go home. Only today, listen to the words. If you choose, I do choose. Thy will be done. This is what we know about God's will, what we see in the open heart and the immediate compassion of Jesus. It's comprehensive, in other words, this kingdom project. It touches every kind of pain there is. It's personal, focused on every individual who's hurting, and it's bigger than personal. It puts the community back together, gives people back to each other. It's about life in its technical sense, with the cancer and lung disease and Alzheimer's vanquished. And it's about life in its broader sense, fulfilled, free, rewarding, whole. This is every beautiful thing we can imagine, promised. Now, if we did nothing more than come together once a week to remind ourselves of the vision, that in itself would be worthwhile. I've spent this week immersed in the issues of immigration and detention and family separations. On Monday night, that vigil in Normandy Park, Pat and Dan were also there. We heard one eloquent speaker after another, a pastor herself from Guatemala, talking about the week-in, week-out traumas that her congregation suffers. A girl from Highline High School describing the fear that Stan told us about back when he started his new job. These young people going to school every day worrying whether their parents will still be there when they get home. Teachers from that school troubled about the truancy rate, the drugs, the going on in the park. Kids in trouble because many of them, especially the boys, are losing their way on account of that message that society doesn't want them. A Methodist bishop publicly setting the Attorney General straight on his Bible quotations. And music. Nada te turbe, nada te stanco. Nothing upset you, nothing frighten you. There were 300 people there, but you could feel one heart beating. And then came Wednesday and the briefing session at St. Mark's Cathedral. Again, 300 people there. Melinda came. We received the information we were all hungry for about how asylum works, how many people exactly are being detained, what the situation is with the children, what's being done, what we could do. One speaker mentioned that President Trump was expected to issue an executive order within the hour that could change the situation. And sure enough, by the end of the day, after we thought we had a handle on what the information was and what was going to happen, the target moved. And all those letters we'd signed now didn't quite hit the target, at least didn't hit the bullseye like they had done, although they were still worth signing. But here we are again today, waiting for clarity about how parents caught up in one government system are ever going to hope to be reunited with children caught up in a different system, while whole new families are being detained, where, for how long, indefinitely, and talk about new detention centers having to be built because the old ones won't contain them all. Every day this week, I was intending to send you an email with updates and here's what we should do. And then every day, the situation was different. More about that when we come to our announcements. Because for the moment, our focus is this prayer. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We pray it because we've seen in Jesus what it's like when the kingdom comes alive among us. We pray it because for all our hard work, it's going to take more than what we can do to make the world right. We pray it because it tells us who we are. Here's how one writer puts it. As Christians, to us has been given the grace to know that we live between the times, having seen the fullness of God in Jesus Christ, yet knowing that all the world is not yet fulfilled as God's world. That tension, stretched as we are between what is ours now in Christ and that which is yet promised, is our role as God's people. We, you and I, are living, breathing evidence that God has not abandoned the world. That is what we bring to the table when all the activists gather. Our beingness as living, breathing hope. We may be earthen vessels, but we are alive with a treasure we didn't invent and couldn't begin to control. We have this treasure entrusted to us just for believing in it. So our job is to show up. It's what we were about when we marched at Pride with our banner. It's what our reader board is for. It's why we take offerings. There aren't a lot of us, but our lives are caught up in a project that's bigger than we are. More than anything, we simply embody the confidence that evil is not going to win. God is. We can't say when or how. But the example Jesus set is about living deeply into the moment where we are, the place where we are set. and bringing hope, one word, one person, one issue, one situation at a time. So that's what we do. However and inadequate those words, however small those actions may seem to be, they proclaim with Jesus that the time is now and the kingdom is at hand here, close enough to touch for any who will turn themselves in its direction and believe. Someday it will be all in all. In the meantime, we have this prayer from Jesus. He doesn't recite it in Mark's gospel, interestingly, but wow, does he live it. And when we pray it, we align ourselves with what he saw, what he trusted, and what he lived. Don't ever apologize when you're feeling small. When people around us are hurting, and that cry of, "Oh Lord, how long," wrenches our hearts, we do feel helpless. There's only so much our human efforts and resources can accomplish. But united with the purposes of heaven, they are powerful. God uses them to change the world. Amen. Sing with me. The hymn is printed in the bulletin. We'll stand and sing together, inspired by love and anger. Project, the kingdom project in our world. Please be seated.